Welcome to Science Club. So thanks everybody for showing up despite the beautiful weather. We're thinking we should have a science club about weather. And we are always looking for ideas and for speakers, if anybody, and for folks to work on the volunteer group that runs Science Club. So if anybody is interested in helping us, because we're all volunteers, or has any ideas for speakers about weather or other good science topics, please let us know. We collect small amounts of money for our small expenses, and we really appreciate that. We today are having a very timely talk about earthquake and engineering, because some people may have noticed that Alaska is a high earthquake state with our recent little event that woke many of us up. So we're very appreciative of that, and we're very thankful for our speaker, particularly because usually we try to arrange these things more in advance. So he was a relatively last-minute speaker. We, for folks who haven't been here before, we start this with a little trivia quiz, not to give you grades, but to get everybody thinking about things, and then maybe take a little more attention during the talk, and maybe learning a little bit better, and it's supposed to be fun. So you should all have a sheet, and let us know if you don't. We are very appreciative of the Taproot for donating this space to us for free, and providing some prizes. We have a collaboration with UAA, although our current speaker is not from UAA. And we also have a collaboration with Alaska Commons, who is taping this. There are YouTube videos on the Alaska Commons website, which is a news magazine or blog with a bunch of interesting stuff. And if you miss any of these or you want to see them again, you can check out the videos there. Now I'm going to introduce James to do the decorating thing. Oh, Julie has some announcements.
Hello, everyone. My name is Julie. I'm the treasurer for Anchor Science Club. And first of all, I want to thank everyone again for the donations that you've made to us over the past year. We were able to pay all of our expenses last year, including our meetup fees, our fees for the business license, for getting our nonprofit status, and we rolled out of the year with a balance of about $700. And so that's going to give us some money to be able to sponsor other events in the community, promote science education, and that kind of thing. So if anybody has any ideas about where that money could be put to good use, we'd be happy to hear about it. So we've had some suggestions in terms of sponsoring prizes at the science fair and that kind of thing. So please let us know if you have any ideas about groups or organizations that could use some donations. Then, I'm also the nominating committee for Anchor Science Pub, and we're going to have our annual membership meeting on March 20th, and so today what we wanted to do was tell you who the slate of officers is that are going to be up for election here at the annual membership meeting in March. So first of all, for president, we have Dan Morris. He's not here today, but he's the person that usually does the introduction, so for those of you who have been here multiple times, you know who Dan is. Vice president, we have Eric Keto. Eric is very talented and is the person who designed our Anchor Science Pub logo, so we thank him for that. I'm the treasurer. Our secretary and communications chair is Karen Schultz, back in the back. Karen does a fine job of making sure our events are posted on Facebook and Meetup, so thanks, Karen, for the great job you do there. Then, our board members are Tony DeHaven. He's been with our group from the beginning. He's not here today. We have Madeline Grant, who is very instrumental in getting speakers for us, so thanks to Madeline. Then another really important person would be Dale Rooney, who helps us with our technical stuff. Okay, James, who does our trivia. So James Howard. Heather Arano in the back, who is from Alaska Commons. AlaskaCommons.com, check out their website. And then Olivia Cohn is not here. So for those of you who are counting, that makes 10 people. And it's really beneficial for a board to have an uneven number. So we certainly could use another volunteer if anybody's interested in being on the board. We're a pretty friendly group. We meet once a month, usually 2 months of the year. So if anybody's interested in being on the board, we meet Sunday afternoons at like 4 or 5 o'clock. So come see me during the meeting, and I'd be happy to add your name to the list. So the elections will be at the annual meeting March 20th, and that's all I have. Thank you.
We will come around and gather up the answer sheets, and we'll introduce our presenter here.
Well, as I said, we're very grateful that Mike Fiora was able to come and talk to us about something that we take for granted and don't think about very much, except when we're woken up at 1 o'clock in the morning. Mike Fiora is a UAA School of Engineering alumni. He works for Reed Middleton. He's been a structural engineer here for over 30 years and has worked as lead structural engineer on a number of buildings that most of you or many of you may be familiar with or have been in or maybe want to be in. Like, I personally have not been in the F-22 flight simulator at Elmendorf, and that sounds pretty cool. The State Crime Lab, the Denali and Eielson Visitors Centers, and the UAA APU Consortium Lab, Consortium Library, excuse me, with the outward leaning walls was a real challenge. But with this, he won an award from the American Council of Engineering Companies, structural award for the design of this. His work involves a lot of collaboration and communication, and we're all really appreciative to have structural engineers thinking about this. Thank you.
Hi. I'm kind of a virgin at this. I've never presented to a group like this. So the first question is, are there any architects out there? Let me hear a clap. There are. Good, because I like to make fun of them. How about any engineers? Are there any engineers out here? Okay. Any structural engineers here? All right, cool. Yes, we all like to make fun of them. But they pay our bills too. So let me fiddle with this, and I'll get the presentation going. Structural engineers design the buildings with earthquakes in mind, and that's why you're all here. And I hear this is kind of a middling crowd, like three quarters full, but this is like 10 times more than I'm used to talking to, so this will be kind of nice. All right, who the heck is this guy? I could have said, who the heck is this guy, or who the heck is this guy? But I was already introduced, so you know a little about me. I do want to say that I was sitting on a flight to Nome, and Julie Olson beguiled me into coming to do this. So thanks, Julie. I'll be finding you later in the presentation. I got a surprise for you. All right. So a lot of this is probably review for some of you, you know, because you're all science nerds, right? You're here to know about science. And though I know a lot about earthquakes, I'm not really an expert. I have to know a certain amount to design the buildings, right? But I'm going to do an overview of earthquakes and then how we apply the structural engineering, you know, to the earthquake motions, and hopefully you'll learn a little something. So everyone knows plate tectonics, you know, we're on a crust that's floating over a molten core, et cetera, so things bump around. And anytime you get movement between the plates, that causes vibrations. If you have big vibrations, that's what we call an earthquake. Earthquakes always occur on faults, which a fault is basically just an interface between two plates. I think the real definition of a fault is a crack where each side of the landmass can move. So if you have a crack, don't say that's a fault. That just might be a frost heave or something. You got to have some movement between the landmasses. And where you do have a vibration, or because sometimes the plates get stuck. They're always trying to move, but pieces of them get stuck. And as they build up energy and release, that's the earthquake, and we call that a rupture. A couple definitions. The epicenter of an earthquake is the point on the surface of the earth, right above where the rupture occurs, and the hypocenter is the name of the spot, you know, at depth. So when they're talking about, you know, something that occurs west of Cook Inlet, like 69 miles down, that's the hypocenter. So a few different types of faults. Slip strike, an example would be the San Andreas Fault in California. We've got the north, at that location, the North American plate is trying to move, I think it's moving south, and the Pacific plate's moving north. So they're, you know, moving like that. And as they move like that, they stick, and then you get the earthquakes. I think it's 2 centimeters a year that the plates are moving apart from each other. You're going to find out the trivia answer. I think it's the correct answer is Los Angeles will be adjacent to San Francisco. Then you've got thrust faults, and that's where they're kind of hitting each other and going like that. And a good example of that would be up here is the subduction zone, the Aleutian subduction zone, where, you know, the 64 quake occurred. Those are the big ones. Those are where huge plates are fighting and energy gets released when they finally relieve the stress. Everyone hear me? Am I doing okay? I've got a laser pointer too. All right, what I have here is a blurry picture. You know, preparing for this thing, I've never done this before, but I found two things is that the Google is awesome, and PowerPoint can just make anything look really pretty. I mean, look at that. It only took a couple days. But anyway, this is a great slide that I found that describes subduction zone movement. And let's see if I can do this. This is interesting. This is kind of what happened in the 64 quake. So this is the Pacific plate is moving north, you know, trying to get under Mount McKinley now, what these are. But as over the years, as it was moving, it kept pushing the land back and back and back and making it get higher. You know, because it's being compressed, and where is it going to go? It's going to squish, it's going to move up. So over the years, you know, decades, that's what happens. And then you get a rupture down here somewhere, and all that built-up energy just springs back. So this that's been pushed up, that might end up being lower, and this out here kind of might slide up. Which is kind of what happened in the 64 quake, right? We had places like Portage, you know, sink, you know, several feet, whereas Middleton Island out in the Prince William Sound rose, just textbook subduction zone quake. All right, so earthquakes generate waves, duh. There's two kinds. There's body waves and there's surface waves. The body waves are the waves that are inside the earth, and then when they hit the surface, they become surface waves. So the body waves, there's two types. There's the P waves, we call them primary waves. I think they're called pressure waves. This is where I wanted to bring one of my, I have a few really tacky visual aids I brought today. The first I was gonna bring was the slinky. But everyone's probably done this in high school or junior high, or where you've got the slinky and you push on it and it makes a compression wave that goes back and forth in line. So those are the P waves. Those are the first ones that come out of the rupture. They're incredibly fast. They go anywhere from like 2 to 8 miles per second through the ground, depending on the density of the rock. And those are the first ones you feel. So in the middle of the night, if you feel a jolt, that's a P wave. And there's more to follow. Then there's also S waves, which we call secondary waves. They're also called shear waves. Honestly, I don't really know what they do, except that they're wiggly, and they follow the P waves. I can't say I've ever felt one. So surface waves. So once this energy gets to the surface, it translates and goes along the surface to where you are to enjoy it. So we've got two kinds. We've got Rayleigh waves and we have love waves. Nobody loves the love wave. I think they're named after someone. So the Rayleigh waves basically move up and down, like swells on an ocean, you know, almost kind of sinusoidal. You'll feel yourself go forward, backward, you know, kind of in a vertical circle. And then there's the love waves. The love waves are the side-to-side ones. Those are the ones that cause the damage. They've got a lot more energy in them because they're in the plane of the soil or the, you know, the surface. And that's where all the accelerations come from. And that's where we get our damage from the love waves. Someone told me I've got like 60 slides, and they said you're supposed to spend 2 or 3 minutes per slide. That's like 3 hours. I'm just tearing through these. Okay, so this is another really nice pencil drawing that some sixth grader probably did. I stole it from the internet, but it really explains what's going on. So boom, there's the rupture. And these little orange guys are the compression waves, the P waves, the slinkies. And then the little green guys, again, I don't really understand those very well. They're shear waves. They wiggle their way up. So as soon as they get up, they hit the surface, and then they travel along the surface to you, you know, in the form of the Rayleigh and the love waves, which we just call surface waves. So this is pretty good. What's interesting is, so the P waves, they're omnidirectional, and they hit you first because they just kind of, let's say we are right there, right at that fault there. You know, they come and they hit you directly, whereas the surface waves, they go up and then over. And as soon as they get to the surface, they're slower. Surface waves are just naturally a lot slower. Has anyone ever heard an earthquake coming? You know, like the ones from the north, the Castle Mountain fault earthquakes. You can always hear those coming. Is there a truck in the neighborhood? But next time you ever feel just a jolt, this is kind of interesting. If you just feel a momentary jolt, that's the P wave. And the longer the distance between that first jolt and the next ones, that really kind of gives you a description of how far away it is, right? Because the surface waves are, you know, trailing behind. So if you feel a jolt and then a big, you know, then the motion, it's probably pretty close. The Castle Mountain faults, they're usually pretty quick between them. You know, last month, let's hear a show of clap if you slept through that earthquake. You guys are handy. It woke me up, and I felt the P wave. I live in South Anchorage, right on the bluff, and so we were the first ones hit. And I felt that P wave, and I went, you know, I felt which direction I came from. I went up, and then the rest of the shaking started. Luckily, it didn't last too long. Okay, so here's the P wave diagram with the slinky, showing the compression, and again, it's Bill Nye the Science Guy kind of stuff that we've all done. But I still wanted to bring my slinky, I couldn't find it. And again, surface waves, the side-to-side ones, those are the love waves that cause the damage. And then the rolly up and down ones are the Rayleigh waves. All right, Richter scale. Richter scale is a point of contention with us because people always come up to me and ask the same question: what magnitude earthquake do you design for? You know, what what magnitude, you know, should that big building be? And we don't design for magnitude. I'll get to that in a little bit. But the Richter scale measures the amplitude of the waves. That's a trivia question. Now, the amplitude of the waves.
Woo! We got it! Yeah!
And most people know that the scale is logarithmic. So an 8 is 10 times stronger than a 7, and it's 100 times stronger than a 6, 1,000 times stronger than a 5, et cetera, et cetera. And it's measuring the wave height, which is, you know, like in electricity, it's a measure of power, right? The higher the amplitude, the more power. So, interestingly, there's a conversion for energy, like the amount of energy released. It's, I think I said about 30 times. It's like 31 or 33 times more per number. So an 8 is 30 times, releases 30 times more energy than a 7, 900 times more energy than a 6, 27,000 times more than a 5. So when you think of the 7.1 we had versus a 9.2, you know, that's you know, almost 1,000 times more energy. That's pretty impressive. And why they do it logarithmically, I don't really know, but it seems to work. So another thing that people don't really realize is the Richter scale was kind of done away with in the 70s. We now use something called the moment magnitude scale. But Richter scale, everyone knows that. It's like calling a tissue paper a Kleenex. So they use the Richter scale on the news, but it's really moment magnitude. And if you're ever really, it uses the seismograph readings, but in a different way. And if you're ever curious, Richter scales, they'll say M sub L, and a moment magnitude is M sub W. That's kind of important if you're ever looking at something back in, you know, the 60s that had a magnitude of something, and then they'll put in parentheses like MW 6.8, because they will be slightly different numbers. So, just thought I'd share some famous earthquakes. Of course, the Good Friday earthquake that we had, that was a 9.2. Loma Prieta, that was the one in San Francisco. That was a 7.1, and that happened during the World Series. So that's the same magnitude as the one we had up here, but it lasted about 20 seconds, 20 to 30 seconds. It was a little shallower, so it had higher accelerations. It did more damage. That's a moment magnitude now. I think when I came up here in the 80s, it was an 8.6, and it's like a fish story. You know, 20 years, it's going to be a 10.9. Northridge was the one in LA back in 94. That one actually changed our seismic codes quite a bit. Nisqually, that's the one they had in Seattle back last decade. And then the Denali Fault one, if any of you were here in 2002, I didn't know we were having an earthquake. That was a 7.9. That's the second biggest earthquake to hit North America the biggest since the 64 quake. You know, that one caused ripples and ponds in Louisiana, and it was just sort of like a byline in the national news. But, you know, the Denali Fault is actually a slip strike fault. So it moved like almost 30 feet. The pipeline actually goes over the Denali Fault, and the pipeline's designed for about a 30-foot movement, and it worked perfectly. Very cool. Inniskin, does anyone know what the Inniskin earthquake is? I don't even know if I'm saying that right, but that's the one we had last month. They gave it a name. It's the Inniskin earthquake, 7.1. And then I found a list of all the biggest quakes in the world since 1900. The one in Chile in 1960 is the biggest that we know of, 9.5. Looking at this list, it makes you realize Alaska gets a lot. Everything around the the Ring of Fire around the Pacific Ocean, so the Chilean coast, Japan, Alaska, we get all the earthquakes. And then Sumatra in the Indian Ocean. I just won't live in Sumatra, apparently. Doing the research on this, I did find something interesting, that back in 1700, we estimate there was a 9.5 in the Seattle, Oregon, Northern California area. If any of you have ever heard of the Cascadian subduction zone, they're screwed. So do you remember the graphic where I was showing how the Pacific plate pushed on Alaska, for a long time, and then it rebounded? Well, it's been doing that to Oregon and Washington for a few hundred years now. And they're thinking, another 9.5. It's not if, but when, because it's actually moved quite a bit. And they're recording that, monitoring it. But that will be exciting. All right. So when we design buildings, we don't use magnitude. Magnitude is just a measure of power. It's a measure of energy. It doesn't tell you how close the earthquake was. I mean, a magnitude's a magnitude, whether you're 10 feet from it or 100 miles. It's always the same magnitude. But, that you can't design for something like that. If you need to know if you're 10 feet from it or 100 miles, right? So what we use are the accelerations. The ones that the love wave jet, I just can't say that straight. Love waves. I'm just going to say the surface waves for now on, because I'm being recorded. So the surface waves, the accelerations, the back and forth, that puts force in our structures. It's a horizontal acceleration. We have a force. We have a mass that's being exerted, an acceleration, F equals ma, Newton's second law. That's all I do. Here's pictures of a couple of our codes, the 2012 International Building Code. It tells us how to design buildings and how to keep them safe. And ASCE 7-10, minimum design loads for buildings and other structures. Has anybody ever heard of that? Really? Yeah, okay. That's my Bible. That tells me by code how much I design floors for. Like if it's in a public assembly, I have to design for 100 PSF. For a place like this would be 60 pounds per square foot, things like that. It tells you how much snow that you have to add into a structure, what the force from the wind, etc. And then of course ice loads, thermal loads, soil loads, all kinds of stuff, and then seismic. And it's a pretty thick volume, and about two-thirds of it is seismic now. All right, we use something called spectral accelerations. I don't know why it's called spectral. I didn't look up spectral, but it's kind of fun to say spectral. It's just the accelerations that are anticipated in an area. And people smarter than me or more interested in them than I am, taking historical data and research and estimates and come up with, wherever you are on the surface, what kind of accelerations you would expect, and it's relative to how close you are to a fault. Okay, so now we've got the distance thing tied in. And what the maps do is they predict a maximum expected acceleration for that area, for something called a maximum considered earthquake, which I thought was the next slide. But this is a typical map. It kind of looks like a contour map, okay? And you can't read any of it, and it's not worth showing you, but like here's Anchorage, and it'll say 150 next to it, well, between 150 and 160. And that's relative to gravity in percent. So. The worst accelerations we can feel around Anchorage would be 1.5 times gravity, so 1.5 G's. So if you're a 200-pound person, you would feel 300 pounds of force from the accelerations, okay? That's worst case, once every 10,000 years kind of an event. So the definition of a maximum considered earthquake is one that has a 2% chance of being exceeded in 50 years statistics. What that means is about once every 2,500 years, you get an event like that. Kind of like rain events or flood, you know, they always talk about 50-year floods or 100-year floods. Well, we have 2,500-year earthquakes. And then nobody designs for that level. It's just unreasonable, because if you have a building that's going to be around for 50 years, 100 years, 200 years, you don't want to design it for that 2,500-year return earthquake. We design for a 500-year return that has corresponding smaller accelerations. And that's what we call our design level earthquake acceleration. All right, so the applied lateral forces, what we deal with is the spectral accelerations, the soil properties, which I'll get into in a minute, and the importance of the building. And we combine all these to come up with basically a force zip on the building. All right, so I already talked about the 500-year return acceleration, and the maps that I was showing show, you know, the closer you are to a fault, the higher the accelerations will be. Soil properties. Are there any geotechnical engineers here? Good, because I make fun of them too. They don't know what they're doing. Well, they do, but they've actually said it's within a magnitude of 10 on you know what they're doing. Because I mean, they're dialing things in more now. There's, you know, seismic accelerometers that you put on the ground to actually record how much parts of town move, etc. So what we do is the accelerations are based on the bedrock, like how much the bedrock would move, and then from that we take factors for the soil. Like, is it a deep soil? Is it silt and clay, or is it gravel? You combine those, and then we adjust the acceleration by those factors. Because if you have like a deep silty layer, it slows down the acceleration, but it increases the amplitude. And so you get that, I don't know if any of you last month felt that rolling motion after the quake stopped. You're on some deep silt, so you were enjoying that ride. But people up on the hillside, they're up on, most of them are on bedrock, so that the shaking wasn't that severe. So the analogy is bedrock is like hard candy. Gravel is kind of like, if you're jiggling it, you know, hard candy doesn't jiggle, but a slice of cake will jiggle a little, and Jell-O just knocks itself out. I was hungry when I wrote that. And then we have the importance factor that we add to the accelerations. We have four types of buildings that we look at, and we call them risk categories. We used to call them occupancy categories. So the more important a building is, the higher a safety factor we put on them. So risk category one, that's like sheds, greenhouses. If they fall over, the importance used to be 0.87, I think, but now they've raised it up to 1.0. Risk category two, that's 95% of all the buildings. This building would be risk category two. Places, you know, restaurants, your house, most normal structures. Risk category three is when you get into places where you have large amounts of people, like schools, universities, places where you have more than 300 people that can sit in one spot. This is getting close, actually. So you want a little more safety factor on those. And then risk category four is what we've always called essential facilities, the ones that you want to have some kind of semblance of operation after the big one. Fire stations, police, hospitals, etc. And then, so risk category two is an importance of 1.0, but something like a fire station, we use a 1.5 safety factor. So whatever force we calculate, we multiply by 1.5 for a fire station. And then to resist those lateral forces, we use something called ductility, which in turn is something we call an R factor. We've, in the last 30, 40 years, we've developed something called the fuse theory. That's not really a real name, it's just what I call what we have a fuse in every building. And then overstrength, where we make some parts of the building stronger than others to deliver the seismic load to the fuse. All right, ductility, visual aid time. I have spaghetti, a coat hanger, and rubber bands. Ductility is a material's ability to deform and then absorb energy after it's yielded. This is quinoa. It's actually pretty good. I tried quinoa, whole wheat, and normal spaghetti, and they all had the same ductility, which was really fascinating to me. Okay, so I'm going to describe something, again, out of high school, Hooke's Law. The load is directly proportional to a stiffness factor times the deformation. So behold the rubber band. As you stretch it, it deforms. If you double the force, it goes twice as long. And then you get to a point where, it's reached its elastic limit. This is where the elastic limit is where it can no longer hold its, go back to its normal shape. See, if I stress it more, well, this one's gonna break, and this one's gonna hurt because it's thick. But some things actually deform more, like the coat hanger. So a coat hanger is an excellent example of ductility. If I press down on it, boing, goes right back. Okay, it deforms, and then if I pull a little too much, I just yielded it. See, it didn't go back to where it was. I've actually weakened this steel. You know, kind of push it back, and no one will know the difference. But, so what this is how do I explain this? So it has a certain amount of elasticity before it yields, right? But then this is called going inelastic. It's permanently deforming. And look at all the, you know, a lot of movement. It absorbed a lot of energy. I really had to put a lot into it, but it didn't fail. It still works, you know, not as well as it used to. This is called ductility. Going back to the rubber band, rubber bands really don't have good ductility because, you know, once you get to that yield point, it fails. So this has no inelastic ability. And to further that, can everyone see this? Can you see that on the camera? Yeah, it's going on YouTube. Okay, so spaghetti actually is a little bit elastic, you know, even when it's hard. You know, when it's cooked, don't throw out the cooked thing because it's completely different. But it has elasticity, and then when you get, see, every time the middle goes. So that failed, right? There's no inelasticity to it, like the rubber band. It failed, it's gone. You can never use this again to resist loads, okay? That concludes my visual aids. All right, so that's ductility. So the R factor is a measure of a system's ductility. And so what happens, especially with steel, is, like you saw the coat hanger, amazingly ductile. It can stretch and bend and deform like 6 or 7 times longer than it originally was, and it will still take some kind of load, which is why we like to build with steel, especially up here. So what happens is we take this reduction factor, the R factor, saying, okay, well, we've got this material, it's going to absorb the load, it's going to deform, and while it's deforming, it's absorbing a lot more energy, so we give a reduction factor, which is a tremendous amount. I mean, if we had to design for the actual accelerations for earthquakes, there would be no windows in any buildings. It would all just be, you know, walls with tons of nails in it, because it's just outrageous. So yeah, we use ductility for our seismic resistance. So yeah, the more energy that can be absorbed through deformation without failure, failure is when the spaghetti breaks, the higher the reduction factor. So this is kind of the fundamental theory behind how we design for earthquakes, with this reduction factor, the ductility of the system. When you have systems that don't have ductility, like stone shacks that don't bend or don't absorb, don't deform, they fall, they collapse, and that's why you see in third world countries, places that build with stone, you get all the damage and the unfortunately the deaths. So this is an example of things I don't know if you've ever heard of or seen before, but this is giving an example of R factors for different systems. I did the engineering building at UAA. It's a special moment frame, has an R of 8. It did move quite a bit in the 7.1, but that was supposed to. Then as you get down to less ductile detailing, the R factors go down. And you've got our shear wall systems. And reinforced concrete, believe it or not, can be highly ductile because you put a lot of rebar in it, the reinforcement bars, and they take the tension. The concrete takes the compression. When it goes into tension, the steel deforms, takes all the energy, and so they actually do very well. And then you've got braced frames, which we can get into later. So just to put it in perspective, let's say you have 100,000 pounds of force from a seismic event acting on a building, and it's a special moment frame building, so you have an R factor of 8. That means you can divide the seismic force by 8. So instead of 100,000 pounds, you're only designing for 12,500. That's going to reach the base of the building. And that's a tremendous, tremendous reduction. So basically, the fuse, the ductile system, is absorbing 87,500 pounds, if we did it right. There's always one, yeah, every earthquake, there's a, if they did it right. So the fuse theory is basically you design a building to have that ductile fuse, the one that's going to absorb all that energy, and you have to figure out a way to deliver the energy to that system. Again, a few more about the fuse. You're going from elastic to inelastic. Think of the coat hanger going to where it's permanently deformed. I mean, in an earthquake, when the fuse deforms, it's destroyed. You have to replace it. But what it does is it prevents the building from collapsing. And that's really the most important part. Not keeping the building operational. That's a whole different level of design. But we want to keep it from collapsing so people can get out safely. Because, you know, a design level earthquake once every 500 years, those just don't come along very often. So we don't design, that's why we don't design for the operation. There's this whole other thing called performance-based design that some clients are going to now, you know, like level of service. Do you want it operational in like a month or maintain operation? Working on some classified military jobs, that are risk category 5, it's top secret, they have to remain operational after earthquakes, so it's just a huge amount of force we're designing for. And again, the inelastic behavior is that range between the yielding and the failure of the element, like the coat hanger from where from the point where it was elastic to where it would have failed, which I'm not even strong enough to have failed that. It would have, you know, been the full height. And that's the inelastic range. Here's a boring graph that kind of summarizes that. The straight part, that's the elastic range. That's where the rubber band, you know, obeyed Hooke's law, and then, or even the hanger. And then once you get past that and into permanent deformation, look at all that. It doesn't get a lot stronger, but you get a lot more strain or deformation, and something that's wiggling back and forth, it has that strength to absorb that. So this is really important. And this is what we use. Okay, so overstrength. So we want to deliver this large force to the fuse and make sure that everything works right. So we design all the elements in the building that are delivering the seismic. You know, we call them drag struts, boundary elements, etc. The connections of those, we design them for 2 or 3 times more load than the fuse. So what that does is it forces the fuse. The fuse is designed for the seismic force, and then everything else is designed 2 or 3 times more. What that does is it forces it to the fuse so that the fuse goes inelastic, so that it's the one that deforms. That's something you're not expecting over in some part of the building, but your lateral element. And then for the seismic analysis, we actually have 4 methods. I will not go into detail. They're extremely boring. But the 2 we mostly use are the equivalent lateral force method, which is kind of like the first push on something. And then dynamic analysis, where it takes into account the mass and the stiffness, the natural period of a structure, and how it responds to the vibration that you're exciting. We do most big buildings using dynamic analysis. So, basic seismic formula, again, Newton's second law, F equals MA. Earthquake force is the weight of the structure times an acceleration coefficient that we developed for what I just described, where that coefficient is, SDS is actually the spectral acceleration, divided by the R factor, divided by the importance factor. This is the most complicated equation I'm showing today, so this is it. So that CS is basically acceleration, so F equals MA. That's all there is to it. That's, yeah, piece of cake. So dynamic analysis is also called modal analysis, or mass modal analysis. And I get to bring up the gizmo. Okay. So the natural period of any structure, any element, any person is their mass divided by some kind of rigidity, a stiffness coefficient. You divide the square root of the mass over that stiffness constant, you get a natural period. So here I have 3 buildings of different heights, but they all have the same mass. But their stiffnesses are all a little different, right? Because this guy is taller and skinnier. So, boing, 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 boing. So that period is pretty slow, but the same mass, boing, 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 boing. You have to do the boing, boing, boing. And then boing, 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 boing. Okay, we made this about 15 years ago at UAA. And it used to be much taller, but the boing boinging, sometimes people get too exuberant and we have to cut them. So this guy used to be about that tall. So over the 15 years, it's gone to boing boing boing. But anyway, this is a good depiction of natural period. So now what I want to show is, if you have an earthquake, how buildings with the same mass get affected by the earthquakes differently. So I need someone to come help me. Julie.
Payback's a bitch.
All right, I need you to stand over here. Like, hold it. There aren't. It actually takes a little bit used to. It's like we're doing a hula hoop. So Julie's going to represent an earthquake. And what I want you to do is you can either tilt it back and forth or move it back and forth. Start out real slow, and what you want to do is move it about that frequency to get that one going. There you go. And just, you know, okay, see what she's doing? So there's an earthquake hitting that tall building at the same frequency as that building, and it's just going to town. And these other guys, you know, he's like, hey, what's up? And this guy is like, well, I'm a little excited, but I don't care. So now the earthquake, you get one that's faster, like you're up on bedrock or something where it's less amplified, and you get the middle one going. This is where it takes a little. There she goes. So keep doing it. Okay, but see now the tall one is hardly affected by that vibration. The middle one, it's resonating with it. Again, this guy's like, hey, whatever. And now the challenge is to get the third one going. You really got to just go to town on it. But it was worth a try. Okay. A hand for Julie. So a dynamic analysis, natural frequency is an important part of the design of the building. If you get a building that matches the natural frequency of the earthquake, like you saw, bad things happen. 1985 Mexico City earthquake. All the Mexico City's on a lake bed, and the way it amplified the vibrations, earthquake vibrations are usually about 1 to 3 hertz, 1 to 3 cycles per second, maybe 10 cycles per second. They're pretty fast. They hit the lake bed, and it went to a 1 second period. 10-story buildings have a natural frequency of about 1 second. So all the 10-story buildings, the mid-rise buildings there, were just destroyed. You know, they fell over, they're demolished, and then, you know, the 50-story and the 1-story ones, nothing. So it makes a big difference. So we use several types of lateral systems. Braced frames, we make those out of steel. A moment, does anyone know what a moment frame is?
Takes a moment to describe.
We always say moment frames, and even when I'm talking to clients or electrical engineers, I'm like, what's a moment frame? Those are the stiff portal frames. They're very, we also call them rigid frames. And just the stiffness of the connections and the heavy members make, you know, resist the elements, as opposed to a braced frame that has the diagonals, you know, like X braces and stuff. So those are taking it axially through the braces, and then the moment frame, its flexure is what's resisting it. So moment frames, because they move a lot, you know, through the flexure, they have a little more ductility, they absorb more energy, which is why they're a good lateral system to use. Oops, too far. Shear walls, that's what you have in your houses. Though a lot of fancy houses kind of are missing shear walls because they'd rather take them out and put in windows, which is scary sometimes. But this is a shear wall building. You've got shear walls between the windows. It's a good system, especially wood shear walls, highly ductile. Wood shear walls are highly ductile. A lot of deformation because wood's naturally flexible. You get nails, the nails slip, you know, the nails can yield and stuff. You don't see a lot of wood buildings that fail. Then cantilevered columns. Don't let a structural engineer let you use cantilevered columns. Again, because the ductility thing, or the fuse, the cantilevered column,
the column is what's supporting your structure, right? And if that deforms, well, the whole structure falls over, so that's the point. All right, so here's some pretty pictures of braced frames. You know, the first one, you got the X braces, I like the point. We call these inverted Vs because they look like upside down Vs, or very technical. Single braces. This is called an eccentrically braced frame. These are, they're a pain in the ass to design, but they work very well in earthquakes. Health Sciences building on the campus, UAA, it's an eccentrically braced frame. And the fuse is that little thing right in there. Those deform, and everything else stays elastic. In fact, it's called the link beam, or the fuse beam. Those work great. There's a three-dimensional braced frame, which I liked, so I downloaded that. Here's one where I think a guy had too much sugar. And I mean, it looks like Texas or something, and everything's just braced, and I don't know what that's for. Unless they're trying to make some kind of hybrid, rigid frame out of all those braces, which actually would be cool. But yeah, that's an example of a braced frame to the max. And then moment frames, you know, we don't have the diagonals in there. It's just the connections between the beams and the columns. I've actually had to explain this to other engineers. This is a column. Horizontal is a beam. And architects just call everything beams, and I don't understand what they're talking about. Here's a good example of a good moment frame. See, it's big and beefy, it's sturdy, and it's got big old connections at the knees. Yeah, that's not going anywhere. That's in fact, it's a strong frame. I actually put one of these in a cabin down across from Homer, over by Seldovia. So we can hide these in wood walls. So like if you've got a big window system or something and you don't want it braces or shear walls, we hide those. They're very expensive. This cabin was pretty close to the epicenter of the January quake, and the guy that I did it for was down there at the time, and he said, yeah, it did just fine. Said, of course it woke him up, but no damage. So I was, my ego was thankful for that. Okay, this is an example in a moment frame. We talked about the fuse. Right there is where we design the fuse. Like in plan, we put a little cut in the flanges of the beam to force that part to fail first. And that's exactly what it does. It crinkles, it crumples, kind of like the crumples on in a car, you know, that absorbs the energy. That's how they design them for crashes. Same thing, it oscillates back and forth, it deforms, it absorbs all the energy. We make sure that the column is about three times stronger, because again, you don't want columns to fall down. You can have a beam get deformed and damaged, but as long as it doesn't collapse, you're fine. People have time to get out of the building. So this is a perfect example of a moment frame connection. These are my favorite. I've done several of these around town. Just did the Kookpik building on 36th, the six-story thing with obnoxious LED lights on it. If any of you have seen that, no. That was a moment frame building. Here's a typical shear wall, wood shear wall. It's what you have in your houses. You know, plywood over the studs. We've got something here called a hold down. Unless you live in a valley, they don't believe in hold downs out there, even though it's a code thing. What code? Here's an example of sometimes you see the vertical straps going on outside plywood when they're putting up hotels around town or something. That's just, you have to get a direct connection all the way down to the foundation. So, you know, as these things are taking load and trying to tip over, you strap them down to the level below you, and then the bottom level is strapped to the foundation. This is what happens when you don't have enough shear wall on a lower level, or maybe you double the width of your garage kind of thing, and then you get a shaker. This is actually an example of what we call a weak story, where you've got a weaker lateral system before a, below a higher one, which is interesting because these windows create a horrible hole in the shear wall system. That glass shear walls, I think there's something to that. But not so much for garage doors. I don't know. That looks destroyed to me. Maybe not the upper story, though, right? There's the only example I could find of a cantilevered column. It's a telephone pole, all right? You know, it's cantilevered. It's rigidly fixed to the ground. I guess my little gizmos are cantilevered columns, too, when you think about it. But you don't want the column to go inelastic, because then whatever it's holding will come down. Other lateral systems, those are the primary ones that we see in like 99% of all buildings. Shear walls, brace frames, moment frames. Other ones that you don't see very often, they're a little more expensive, they're good for retrofits. Viscous dampers, those are good for retrofits. They're like pistons or shock absorbers in your car. They absorb the energy as it moves. The only problem with them is they don't have like built-in springs to get the building to spring back. So the building goes plonk and kind of sits there, and unless you've got some other kind of system to push it back, you just got a diagonal, like a, what's that, leaning tower or Pisa kind of thing. So you usually incorporate those with moment frames. And then base isolators. I like base isolators. We tried to get KTUU to use them for a big antenna dish they had out there, but they just thought it was dumb. They were probably right. But, so here's an example of a viscous damper. You got a little shock absorber, so when the seismic motion moves, it absorbs it, but again, there's nothing to push it back. And I don't know why the dampers don't come with built-in springs like shock absorbers in cars do. Base isolation. I love base isolation because what you're doing is it's the ground that's moving, it's not the building. The building gets its force from its own inertia as its foundation moves. So if you isolate the foundation from the moving ground, you get no force to the building. I would have loved to have added some videos of testing like three-story wood structures on base isolation, like before and after base isolation, and you get the big shake table moving and then the structure's not even moving. It's just like, yeah, whatever. So what these are is like big rubber snubbers or something that you sit all the columns or the footings on, and they're flexible enough to absorb the energy and move with them, but stiff enough to, still hold up the building. My firm is actually successfully installing these in a hospital in Japan, and it's been going very well. I like this. I found this on the internet, that this is a good example of base isolation. The screaming buildings rocking with the earthquake, and this guy's just sleeping through it. So he's on base isolators. So to conclude, I'm just going to read this. Seismic design is continuing to develop, and the code is updated each cycle as we learn more about the behavior of ground motion and structures. This happens through testing, observations of actual events. We still can't predict earthquakes. We use mice and dogs, I guess, to sense them, but we don't really know how to predict them yet. And then, just a fun thing, James Amrine, he's kind of the father of masonry engineering. He developed this quote, which really rings true. Keeps us humble, so our heads don't swell too much, but structural engineering is the art of molding materials we do not wholly understand into shapes we cannot precisely analyze, so as to understand forces we cannot really assess in such a way that the community at large has no reason to suspect the extent of our ignorance. Thank you.
questions and answers next. I was thinking maybe because you ended with that and didn't start with that. Great talk.
So when a fuse deforms, does it have to be cut out and replaced and building repaired?
Yeah, in a design level earthquake, it's damaged. It's no longer adequate. But what it did was it deformed enough to keep the building from collapsing. So like in a moment frame, the beam that you saw, the buckled beam, that would have to be replaced. Braced bays, the braces get these, we call them plastic hinges. Those have to be replaced. That takes, we're talking a 9.5 kind of event, or something definitely over a 9 to cause something like that. Experiences, right? Like all my Star Wars books went flying, but my Pulitzer Prize ones stayed in the. It's telling me something. It really depends on the motion. And in my PowerPoint presentation, this is the Adobe version, but in PowerPoint, I included that accelerometer graph that the Daily News posted about how different parts of the town shook at different, and it was because of the soil amplification. Where I was, we got 0.15 Gs, which is a lot. The 64 quake, the low end of that was 0.15 Gs. So if this thing had lasted longer, we would have had some serious damage around town. Some places just, barely felt it. It was just a fun ride. They went right back to sleep. And people like in my neighborhood, we were going out and checking our gas meters, etc. But it was in my house. All my pictures in the north-south walls were slanted face down to the south. It was kind of weird. So what I think was there was more shaking in one direction than the other. Like the actual love waves were more focused in one direction. Yes.
Question about the science behind it, but the fact that we had so little damage, do you know much about the code, the inspection, the adherence code? You kind of mentioned Wasilla, but I thought we just have a really good code and adherence to it.
Right. So she was asking why, even though it's a 7.1, the same as, the Loma Prieta earthquake, why did we not have as much damage? We're a much newer city. Most things that get damaged are poorly designed or improperly designed, or pre-1970s stuff where they didn't take ductility into account. And again, we don't use a lot of concrete here. Poorly reinforced concrete does fail quite dramatically, but we use steel and wood, two of the most ductile materials that we have to design with. We did get damage around town. I saw several, for instance, stairwells that had cracking in their CMU, the block masonry stuff. Those were old buildings that were, probably didn't have enough detailing and the reinforcement. I understand that West High School had some damage, that one kind of went for a ride. For the most part, and especially for the newer buildings, they can take a lot larger accelerations than we had. Yes? There's like three hands in this family. It's going to be the little one. He's going to stump me.
Thank you.
So the question was asked if earthquakes all occur at like the same elevation underground, or different earthquakes, you know, if they all occur at that same elevation. No, it's a subduction zone quake, for instance, is really deep. Like the rupture will be 60 to 100 miles below us. But you get shallow faults, like it's called the Castle Mountain or Castle Ridge, Castle Mountain Fault, which is up near Willow. That one goes all the time. Like once a month, we get at least a 4 out of that. And every once in a while, we get the 5s. Those are shallow. Those are within, you know, 10, 15 miles of the surface. They can be at any depth. In the black.
Yeah, I was curious, especially considering the Cascadia. I've read some articles about Seattle. Just as you mentioned, you're screwed.
They're screwed. Yeah.
And in the Bay Area, like I was in bed for this last one. In '89, I was in center field, at Candlestick. Have the more major metropolitan areas, have they improved to the level where, you know, we can expect less damage than an entire city basically falling
right
down?
Actually, the Loma Prieta earthquake created a big retrofit movement throughout the United States on the most of the damage occurred to under or non-reinforced concrete. Like the Bay Bridge collapse, et cetera. And they found that some of the detailing that they were using was inadequate, and the columns would just rupture outward from some of the accelerations. And so now what we've learned from that is to add more, it's called confinement steel, to keep it intact. And then things that are don't have reinforcement, like a lot of stone masonry, like think about Art Deco things on tops of buildings that can sway and just crack and fall, you know, several stories. So we have ways of retrofitting those with, we call it FRP, fiber reinforced plastic wrap, where we can coat it on top of concrete, and it's a very ductile material. Then you coat that with a skim coat or something, so it looks like it's part of the concrete. But yeah, ever for the last 20 years, we've been doing lots of retrofits. Yes?
I used to work in a 3-story with a basement office building. It was reinforced masonry with wood interior floors, probably supported with some sort of steel support. When that building were to fail, how would it fail? Would it survive? Would it totally collapse? Would it fall over?
What would a masonry building do? They usually develop diagonal cracks between the courses. And what were the floors made out of?
They were wood floors.
Okay, then that's where it would have failed. After Northridge earthquake, what we discovered was a lot of buildings with concrete or masonry walls and wood floors. The wood floors would pull away from the rigid, heavy concrete, right? Okay, because in an earthquake, the concrete is really feeling a lot more load because it's all related to the mass. So the walls pull away from the wood diaphragm, and then the wood ledgers, they're not designed to take that kind of direction of load. They're there, you know, just take vertical people load. And what would happen is they would split apart. It's something called cross-grain tension or cross-grain bending. You picture wood is just a bunch of straws put together, okay? And when you're loading the straws, you know, along their length, they're very strong. But if you pull them apart, there's really no bond between them. So what happened is these walls would pull away from the diaphragms, the floors, and then the floors would just collapse. The walls no longer had any lateral support, and then they would collapse. So now, since Northridge, we have requirements where we're not allowed to put any wood what's anywhere in cross-grain bending. Yes?
You talked about natural frequency of the building in Mexico City.
was that determined, or could you determine that before the earthquake, or was it only after the earthquake that you realized there was a natural frequency?
I don't know. I don't know if the scientists down there realized that the 10-story buildings would be in peril, and or you know, if it was just one of those things where they discovered it after the fact. But it was pretty cataclysmic. I actually had an architect friend that lived there when it happened, and she said it was just very traumatic to see those come down, and why God only picked on the 10-story buildings and not the other. Yes?
Well, I'm a carpenter, so we take the more perspective than as an architect and engineer. How to build stuff that you can't build. But that's beside the point. I was here in the region for that 6.2. I was in a four-story apartment building. It was like 6:30 in the morning. Do you hear during that one?
Yes. I was in the second level of a wood townhouse. I went out on the balcony to watch it.
I was half out on the first floor window in my skin. But as I'm out there hanging out my window, I saw a wave go through my window. Just, it was about 60 inches tall, about 20 inches at the base, top half of the sine wave. It took almost 3 seconds to get through a 60-foot lane of my living room. And I'm sort of wondering, can you describe how that can propagate through a wood building and survive it? It was parallel to the joists, and the telephone poles outside, which were parallel to this way, were swinging about 12 feet. Direction.
So, yeah. Being a carpenter, I thought stuff would have been slippery before. It could survive the little way this tall about this worldwide going through that hole. I've never seen anything like that. It sounds cool. But again, you know, wood, because you, as a carpenter, you know just how flexible wood can be on a bigger scale. You know, like if you have a 2x8 plank, you can set it across a trench, you know, 6 feet, and you know, when you walk on it, it definitely, you know, you can get a few feet of sag on it as you walk across, right? So to have a wave like that pass through, I'm actually surprised you didn't get any damage or have nails come out, like you're saying.
Yeah,
I had the connections.
The walls were separated.
Yeah. That's a cool story. Yes.
Did you say the first waves we would feel were P waves?
Yes.
So the stories I read about the 64 earthquake, some people mentioned their animals felt something before they even felt anything. What were they feeling?
It's a little out of my expertise, but I think sometimes they emit something called the ultra-low frequency waves that you can't really hear, but you can almost feel. Has anyone else heard of that phenomenon? The built-up stress in rock, well, they're talking about ultra-low frequencies. So, yeah, they think that's what animals feel or detect before a big quake. Okay. It could. If you have a large enough event where you're concerned about the fuse or the lateral system, you call a structural engineer. There's actually a lot of us are trained to go do a post-disaster assessment. We're all on call with the building department. So they call us, and then we go out, and then we red tag, yellow tag, or green tag buildings. It's a real quick visual assessment. So if you have an event that's that dramatic, you know, we go out and look at things like that in red tag. But you might have something like a shear wall that got damaged, you know, pulled away from the foundation, and no one looked at it. And then the next one that comes, there is potential, you know, unless you checked it. But usually for a house, it's pretty obvious if something's moved or changed. You'll see cracks in the sheetrock that weren't there a minute ago. But for the most part, again, you know, wood frame buildings do really well with earthquakes. Okay.
Mike, we have for you, courtesy of Tapper, actually, three free drink tokens and a $25 gift card. Here, so
I appreciate that.
I do need a drink.
And that was a great talk. I want to say you're a natural. You may need to do this again. And great questions, too. And now our trivia quiz, because some of you may be wondering the answers that were answered.